now. Yasuo's most likely targeted at Void Boy. He had a victorious Yasuo game. One of the few to actually win with Yasuo here in North America. Mm-hmm.
And of course, the Jinx ban aimed at double lift. And I think of all the right popular AD carries right now, Jinx is the most double lift-esque. It's the most late game carry. It's actually got good lane presence along with the other AD carries. And it's like, yeah, let's remove one of those double lift factors.
Yeah, and if they ban Annie as well, those would be the same bans that EG did against CLG to much success yesterday. I think it's personally a smart choice if they decide to go in that direction, because once they got rid of CLG's bottom lane, they could deal with Hotshot, and then there was two of the three lanes kind of dealt with, and Yen wasn't able to take over.
We'll see.
I think he's done this every time.
Yeah, he picks the same two, the same two. Now, to be fair, Teemo's like undefeated in LCS right now. I want to see at some point.
I feel like Teemo's going to be undefeated in the LCS for a while.
Because they'll keep getting banned against C9, and no one else has the skill to run that champion.
Mm.
Teemo hard to play with his zero skill shots and auto attack reliance.
There's plenty of champions that are hard to play without skill shots. I'm personal to the Uter myself, mm-hmm. and no skill shots on that guy.
You just match your face in the keyboard.
Yeah,
you gotta
be smart about where
you go. That's true. All you have is your intelligence in the game. So there you go. That CLG is still taking their time
on
these picks.
Well, what could he do? Like, there's a bunch of top laners available. Mm-hmm. Elise is also available.
Yeah. All right. So Link on Elise right here, and you actually mentioned that they fought EG with the same bans that EG brought up them. So they've got to be like, oh, we screwed up and took this champion too late. Like, that's fresh in their minds. They can make that adaptation.
I should hope so, but they also don't know exactly what they're up against. That's Caitlyn again for Kopp. He's had a couple really strong Caitlyn games so far this week. And then the Lulu is taken away from Aphromoo. I feel like they're really trying to push Aphromoo off of his comfort. I expect Aphro to basically have to go with Thresh. Mm-hmm. It's pretty bold, actually, by Zekan to pick Lulu that early, seeing as the normal power level of supports would just say, oh, and he's banned, let's pick Thresh. But it's because Aphromoo has so much comfort with him.
Yeah, and an interesting thought sort of about this, these sort of lane setups as well, is my understanding is like double lift Aphromoo are like Kopp Zekan's kryptonite. Like, Curse loses the 2v2 lane so hard against CLG. In scrims, to be fair, but both the players, both Kopp and Doublelift, tell me that, like, it's a really one-sided matchup. And with Kate Lulu, like, it's a really good push lane for a 2v1.
Yeah, that's definitely a push comp starting out. And knowing that CLG is most likely going to the Nidalee, even though that is a poke comp at the moment, it's not the fast push right off the bat. Nidalee does have some issues with wave clear at the start of the game, but no surprises with the Mundo and Nidalee pick for CLG.
So now, does Curse know what was coming here? CLG said they had tricks up their sleeves in the preparation for this game. But these are very standard so far.
Yeah. If they're tricks, they'd have to be something like a double bruiser bottom lane.
Like Darius Maokai?
Darius Maokai.
We're waiting for it, guys.
Not going to happen.
Hey, if I got my Teemo in LCS on the very first game, you get your Darius Maokai at some point.
It's not going to happen, Freak. I'm sorry.
You'll just have to bribe the players.
It takes too much time for that to develop.
The mastery?
Unless I am in the LCS myself, I don't think I'll get to see it.
Okay, we'll see. You can always make the run for it.
Yeah.
Summer Split's coming up soon. There we go. Vayne and Thresh coming through here. So counter Logic Gaming, putting the carry pants on the double lift. More of a skirt, I guess he's Vayne.
Yeah, surprisingly, with Vayne, double lift loves to split push. And that's kind of the old CLG where double lift is off on his own doing farming. We'll see if it ends up working against these guys. He will be able to dual Kopp if he doesn't fall behind once he gets later on. Mm-hmm. The early laning phase might necessitate some lane swapping unless they're just that confident that they can win a 2v2. Caitlyn theoretically beats up on Vayne in the laning phase.
Yeah, should be a pretty scary one here if you're double lift. Now we'll see what follows through here with the last picks now for Curse. Of course, they picked up Gragas and Shyvana. No stranger to the competitive scene. Gragas, Nidalee, I feel like should be a good one for Void. Mm-hmm. Oh.
It's exactly what Pobelter did against Hotshot. Mm-hmm. He had a spectacular game on Kha'Zix. He actually ate double lift in about half a second by the end of the game. Void Boy, again, is on an Assassin champion as well, which fits him in the mid lane. This Curse lineup seems like they picked in and around what CLG was going to bring very well. I don't see any surprises by CLG. Mm-hmm. And even though Curse's lineup seems very standard, most of these things are strong counters against one another. The Shyvana in the top lane should be able to push Nien back early on. Void Boy should be able to get an upper hand on Hotshot GG's Nidalee. Even the Caitlyn should have more pushing than Vayne. So every lane for Curse is actually poised to win.
Yeah.
And CLG is like playing from behind just from champ select.
All right. Well, Jat, we're going to talk more about these picks in a little bit. But guys at home, you talked about who you thought was going to win on LOLesports.com. And according to you, 57% said that Curse was going to make it a 3-0 to start the season out. So online fans in favor of Curse here, man.
OF times have changed. I remember back in season 2 and even early season 3, no one would have voted Curse over COG because oftentimes Curse are just made up of members of COG that had been removed from the team. But now it's just Voidball remaining from that bunch. And Curse, 2-0, undefeated so far. I do not disagree with that vote.
Yeah, they're looking pretty good. They win this game. They're tied for first with Cloud9. Mm-hmm. And that's a good way to start the season. Of course, they'll play their fourth game later today as well. And heck, you got teams starting out 4-0. Like, you're in a really good position. Now, the other question I wanted to ask you, though, is you talked about having a standard composition, but the Jungle Gragas, something I've not seen much of, at least in pro play. Tell me about this from Dominate.
Yeah, so the Jungle Gragas is actually very dependent on getting a lot of kills early. So his early game jungle is actually extremely strong because he gets a lot of AD from his W and his ganks are really potent. But then his itemization gap after he finishes his Spirit of the Spectral Wraith is a very large item gap. He wants to basically get a death cap after that, and unless he's getting kills, he can't generate that farm. Late game Jungle Gragas is spectacularly powerful, and so is early game. It's just the mid game where it has a dip.
And it's interesting to me because we see, like, I remember Nintendude's Jungle Fiddle was like Tank Fiddle, for example. We've seen so few players play like true carry-esque champions out of the jungle. The closest we normally see is someone like Olaf, who tends to be a very big damage threat, but like most guys go tanky out of the jungle. Even at least like Magic Pen, but still goes Ancient Golem. Gragas is like the one guy I think we see, aside from maybe Evelynn, who really builds damage out of this role. And it's fun to see the different takes.
Yeah. This is going to be another fairly assassin-heavy team for Curse, especially since I Will Dominate definitely goes in for them. Quas will be that one super tank. And in this situation, I feel like it works. Normally, I'd say that you want two tanks for your frontline. Become the dive buddies. But especially with Mundo and Shyvana, they're some of the few that can function quite well as being the sole tank in the initiations.
Well, let's see if Curse's lineup then pans out right here. Everybody drawing standard battle lines. No one looking for the 2v1s either. If they wanted them, they'd have to move right about now as minions have spawned up. The trinkets coming across from these guys. Doran Shield starting the supports. And here we go. Looks like actually a recall from Cop, so Curse going to be lane swapping this one.
Very surprising that Curse has decided to lane swap this one, seeing as they theoretically would win the 2v2 against Thresh and Vayne. I'm expecting them to just play a very fast push strategy here, try and trade as many turrets as possible, and then get into the rest of the game. Quas has had a lot of success in the LCS thus far, coming back from 1v2 situations and still being very successful. So Zekant is going to do his best to zone out Nien here. And also, if we think to yesterday, Nien had a huge struggle against Evil Geniuses in the 1v2. He died multiple times to Snoopy and Inox.
See if you can have a better time at this one. The jungler's actually going to be ending on the same side of the map right here. So a bit of a lopsided situation. Nien's going to be there for the 2v1 push, but
Oh my god, are you serious, Aphromu? Well, that's pretty good for CLG.
That is a huge move by Aphromu. And it's so exciting because yesterday, or the first LCS game that CLG had, there was a similar thing where the other team invaded Link and Doublet and Aphromu just stuck to their lanes. But this time, Aphromu was just peeking just to see what was happening. And Dominate was actually taking the blue buff without having his smite up, so he couldn't secure it. And since Aphromu had that charge kind of super attack from his E being on Thresh, just can't even get the words out because that was very unexpected.
That was, yeah, you get to be flabbergasted for that one. That was super awesome. CLG with a huge experience advantage now. Aphromu, I think almost the first champion in the game to hit level 3 because of that. They're already on the turret. Quas nowhere to be seen, and Link is already here.
And this really hurts the early game of Wild Dominate's Jungle Gragas. We haven't seen any Jungle Gragas in North American LCS, which is, well, I was kind of excited for this one to happen. When he gets his blue stolen away from him so early, he is immediately playing from behind. His early game edge has just evaporated in front of our eyes, and COG's kind of weak lanes with the fast push are now actually doing decently well because of the blue steal. Yeah. And because there's no way Owl Dominate can have presence in lanes without those buffs.
And this turret is going to go down without Quas even showing up to it before it falls. So there we go. CLG, first turret right here. And you still have Dominate finally hitting level 3, but definitely not having his like mark made on the map here.
Yeah, this is a disastrous fast push strategy by Curse so far. The top lane has only taken down half of Nien's turret, and he's still at full health. Kopp and Zekan are trying their best to take it down, but on the other side with CLG, like, they're going to continue this push until they feel like they have to go otherwise, and they don't. There's no threat from I Will Dominate right now.
And Doublelift's even winning in minion kills right now as they're kind of pushing up a little bit farther on the map right there. Second tier turret also under fire. As you mentioned, still the top turret for CLG, not going anywhere whatsoever. And the other thing I think about as Dominate now hits level 4, but I remember seeing a game back in the summer split where Meteos lost all 4 of his buffs, I think to Dignitas.
Yep.
And he just like
went and pushed.
Just showed up top lane with Nasus and was like, yeah, I don't care, whatever. We talked to him about it after the game, and he's like, yeah, I just pushed. It wasn't a big deal. Dominate's defending with no buffs.
Yeah, and that was also before teams really understood how these 3v1 and 3v2 pushes work. At this point, Dominate will get experience and catch up a little bit that way, but his team is falling far behind in overall minion kills. On the next wave, there's a good chance that CLG will just finish off that turret, and Curse is just barely finishing off the turret in the top lane.
Yeah, there we go. It's going to fall likely on this wave. Nien doesn't have too much more to defend it. He is winning on minions against Quas here, but keep track of the other lanes. Hotshot is also keeping Voyboy pushed in. So basically, CLG winning the push race pretty much everywhere on the map. There's the two towards bottom lane, and now they get a pretty safe rotation out.
Just a disastrous start so far from Curse. Giving up straight away two turrets for one, even though they're the team with the Caitlyn. That just can't happen if they're trying to make a run here as being a top North American LCS team. They're going to have a lot to recover from that break.
We'll see if these guys can do it now. And the Dragon now also being started. Look at the Dragon dancing here by CLG. Aphromoo making that happen pretty nicely. Good move right here. And just slowly but surely, Doublelift dealing damage with his Silver Bolts.
Yeah, to explain actually what's happening there, the Dragon will always prioritize to try to attack it, but he's got extremely slow attack speed. So when he goes to wind up his attack, if he then sees a different target, he'll actually cancel his own attack and not hit anyone, mm-hmm. and constantly kind of switch back and forth. So you could see Aphromoo there on Thresh just running to be the closest target and not the closest target, back and forth again, and they took almost no damage from Dragon. We see a lot of pro teams do that nowadays.
That's very well played. I've even seen videos of like trying to solo Dragon. It will attack wards, and so you'll like hit it with Shaco, pop a ward down to interrupt an auto attack just to get enough space to do it. There's a lot of little tricks you can do when you understand the Minion Aggro rules. Pretty fun game. Voyboy, though, level 6, maxing Q, and also evolving Q here. So extremely high spike damage available if Voy singles someone out.
Yeah. At the moment, though, he's just in farm mode. He's honestly done pretty well against Hotshot early on in the lane, knowing that it was a melee versus ranged matchup. Hotshot wasn't able to punish whatsoever early on. Considering neither team had any jungle pressure in that mid lane, it was a straight up 1v1.
Okay, so here we go. 10 minions different. Looks like the early Tiamat started out here for Voyboy. Hotshot again going for Seeker's Armguard. Try to survive the eventual burst damage here. Hotshot hits 6 with a blue buff 7 minutes in. And that mid lane's so far stagnant, but I imagine it explodes before too long as Voy gets more power.
I think we're going to see Voy trying to roam around and make some plays. Mm. Doublelift missed that CS?
Yeah, he missed a CS.
Doublelift. Shame.
He's actually 14 minions behind Kopp out of nowhere as well. I don't know where he ran.
That's not to be blamed on him, though. Oftentimes when they're pushing more turrets, minions fall by the wayside, and also he helped his team secure Dragon.
Oh, that's true.
So at the moment, this is the Doublelift that existed in the game that CLG won this weekend. He was lower on farm, mm-hmm. but CLG overall was taking more objectives. Whenever he's 30 or 40 CS up on the enemy AD carry, or more importantly, the thing to track with Doublelift,
yeah.
is if he's like 40 or 50 CS on the rest of his team,
yeah.
is when they're not doing well, because it means he's taking a disproportionate amount of farm away from his team, and he's just not able to carry the game on his own.
Yeah, and kind of keep a track of Doublelift as well. He's the only guy I really see, or one of very few, who goes Bloodthirster Vayne as opposed to Ruin King, which is normally much more popular elsewhere in the world.
Hmm. So he's been doing Bloodthirster since before Blade of Ruin King was a thing.
Yeah. Well, that's because it's all you could ever build.
Yes.
But he kept with it. He's not a man who likes change. Did not vote for Obama. And here we go. Nien's
because he was too young, freak.
Might have been. I don't actually remember exactly how old he is, but that's all right. Hotshot GG and Aphromoo now showing up in the mid lane, and it's the double lift Vayne split push. They've pulled the support somewhere else. Mm-hmm. Looks like Aphromoo's brought his spoons elsewhere, and he's trying to help out somebody on the middle of the map, but not a lot of headway given, actually. Azeekin also made that same rotation.
Yeah, COG has a lot of control of the map right now. You can see Owl Dominate's just now trying to get back in the game, really just trying to farm up, and he hasn't made any real appearances in the lane. Link, on the other hand, while it looks like he's a little bit lower on farm, was all the while pushing that lane. Lisa's very good in a 3v1 push because it's a very safe 3v1 push and she has the access to those ranged auto attacks. And now I feel like COG is just trying to group up and push. This is the training that they've been trying to get towards. Whenever they can actually execute this strategy, they generally win.
And a giant rotation now towards the top lane as well. CLG really wanting control over the map. It's actually going to be Nien sitting there in the mid lane for one more wave. But four members top lane here for CLG, and that forces a recall from Voyboy and a complete numbers advantage here.
This could be another turret here for CLG. It's too many people on CLG in there and not enough for Curse. And surprisingly, everyone in Curse is on their base, so even though everyone on CLG showed, they can't defend this turret. CLG is rotating very strongly right now, and Curse is just way behind in response.
Here we go, three turrets to one now, 10 minutes in. Counter Logic Gaming still even has an outer turret to kill in that mid lane if they want it. Nien still holding this one strong, has the teleport if he needs to rotate. Dragon in a minute and a half, CLG doing an amazing job of objective control, and because of those turrets, their individual gold is great as well.
Yeah, everything kind of ticking properly for CLG. This is the methodical game that they like to play. It's again, I can't emphasize how well this early game is actually going for CLG, because if you were to look at the actual matchups, if the lanes would have went down in a standard fashion, almost every one of their lanes would have lost.
That's true.
But because they did the 3v1 swap, because Aphromoo was able to steal the blue buff, and because all the pressure was removed from the mid lane, and Hotshot's actually been doing very well in his 1v1, everyone is doing well, and Curse, with a team that was stronger in the early game, is losing the early game badly. So CLG, it's going very well for them right now.
Oh, good job by these guys then. Again, strategic play has been sort of the hallmark of CLG, I guess, in the season so far. I think compared to the old CLG, it's the strategic play that's keeping them up, more so than individual carrying. And that's kind of cool to see. It's cool to see the new look for these guys. Of course, Curse right now, though, I feel like it's much more individual focus just in champ select, because you've got champions like Kha'Zix who can take over a game. Kopp on Caitlyn, who's going to be able to sit there in the back lines and just fire down at people. So if he gets big, and, you know, Bloodthirsts are done now on this Kate, like, there's still the threats here from Curse, of course.
Yeah, I think Curse, if all farm was equal, would have a stronger team fighting phase, only because I Will Dominate and Kwass bring a bit more to the team fight than Nien and Link do. And then Voyboy going in to assassinate people is a much different type of thing that Hotshot would bring, where Hotshot's just poking with spears. CLG's going to want to split push as much as possible come the later game, but for now they're roaming around and controlling it. There's a bit of danger here that they get caught in a bad team fight.
Here comes the damage out, but that is going to be Dragon picked up, and will the fight start? Kwass getting hooked in, has the ulti though. Caitlyn ult comes off, hits double lift a bit, and now the Lulu ult pop. Dominate's going to knock people in. Hotshot not in range to get jumped on though. CLG has the disengage if they want it.
Yeah, Curse burned too many spells to continue that chase. There was actually a Lulu ult that got popped on Kwass that really didn't do anything. You normally see the Lulu Shyvana combo where she dives in and knocks everyone up, but now they're actually down a lot of key spells. CLG could try and initiate this one, or at least turn in some kind of siege down the middle lane, because most of Curse's big spells are down right now.
Well, here we go then. The mid lane under siege by these guys. Took the dragon, kept going for this one. There we go. Mid lane turret down to half HP, running out of minions though. And kind of Logic Gaming will back off. No, they won't. They just switch aggro. Another turret falling. CLG controlling everything.
Exactly. There was nothing left with Curse to threaten with. No Gragas ultimate, no Lulu ultimate, no Ace in the Hole from Kopp. It meant CLG could just set up their siege. This is what they like to do with the Nidalee composition. Nidalee and Elise and the Mundo Cleavers is a lot to poke at the enemy team. Hotshot 1-for-1 on Siege Spears so far. That's about 100% better than he was the other day.
Seems that way. Here we go. Mid lane Siege still going. Kwass forced to go back to base to heal. And Dominate sacrificing the mid lane turret just to grab his own blue buff here. So Counter Logic Gaming, 13 minutes in, have five turrets from Curse.
Yeah, that is a tremendous number. Now, Curse doesn't necessarily have very good wave clear when they're trapped at their turret, unless I will dominate, get some AP under his belt. It's because he hasn't made it out of this bunk that he has an itemization right here. He's just on the Spirit of the Spectre Wraith. The barrels can't clear yet. Kopp just has the Bloodthirster, and there's not even a full Ravenous Hydra yet on Void Boy for trying to get the split push going. There is a lot of wave clear potential for Curse later, but they just haven't ramped it up yet, and that's why CLG has done such a good job of capitalizing on it and getting five turrets so early.
So very good job with the early game here by these guys. The test I always consider is what do you do once you get to six? Because inhibitor turrets are so hard to kill. And as we've seen, you talked about this in the pregame to the actual show itself, North American team's been closing out games rather quickly here. Chronologic Gaming about halfway to that mark right here, 15 minutes in. And now, CLG double if split push starts. Oh, yes.
And this is a thing that Curse has to take into account here. It's worth noting that Nien is going to be extremely hard to kill for this Curse composition, and it works very well for CLG's Siege. Now that CLG has an edge, and they put down a lot of turrets, they're going to be wanting to siege with that blue buff Nidalee. And Curse's only way is to just go all in on an initiation of getting something back. And since Gragas doesn't have any ability power, everyone else is mainly physical damage, and Nien has already finished a Sunfire Cape and Ninjatabi. If Curse tries to initiate, they have to make it through the Mundo, and that just doesn't seem very possible right now. It means CLG can barely safely siege as long as they have everyone there and as long as Mundo acts as a frontline deterrent.
What are the chances that Curse can somehow walk past him with like upgraded wings, Caitlyn ulti, like Shyvana dive? Is that even a possibility here for Curse to get around that?
I think it's very low as far as possibilities are concerned. Kopp is so far behind in itemization compared to how strong Mundo is right now. And the team also has to focus very much on just getting multiple targets low. I do not think they can get past that line. Otherwise, in the end, we'll just have free reign.
Ooh, man. Kwas, half health from a javelin there. I don't know if he took damage before then, but certainly is low now. And Kwas runs back to base to heal. Boots one, not even a completed Sunfire, certainly being outscaled by Nien here. And CLG continuing on the siege. That one hit the minion.
Whoa.
Oh my gosh, Kopp! Very low, gonna pop the ulti on double if, but he'll
live. Hotshot's on his game today. Those spears are homing right now, making everyone on Curse go back. And there's just no way they can initiate, A, because the spears are landing, but B, because they are just very far behind without much damage potential. The acceleration of this game is really catching Curse off guard.
Good job here by CLG. And they were the team who was playing aggressively in their win over XDG yesterday. So it just seems that Counterlogic Gaming so good at turning the tables here. Hotshot pokes out, lands another javelin. Dominate losing some of his health. And there's the top lane push, a little bit of wave clear. CLG actually are respecting the Gragas quite a bit.
They are afraid of someone getting knocked in. At the moment, they don't have the Mundo there. So if a squishy target did get pulled into the turret, it would have to be some really impressive Thresh Lanterning to get them out. It'll be interesting to see how long Curse can hold this turret. Because if they can hold the stall for a little bit longer, they will start catching up a bit in gold, and Dominate might get some items.
But Dragon is coming up in about 50 seconds. Let's see if CLG pulls off the take that, if Curse gets to sneak it with someone, or what happens off that objective. CLG making very slow, but steady, to be fair, progress on that second tier turret. It's going to make it number 6 if they make that happen. Nien the whole time has been going back and forth between mid lane and bottom lane, getting bigger and bigger. 144 minions on him. He's about to have top score in the team if this keeps up.
Yeah, and we were talking earlier about when COD is playing well, Doublelift doesn't have a disproportionate amount of farm compared to the rest of his team. And that's one of the reasons they're doing well this game. Nien has 152 on Mundo, and Doublelift is hitting at 161. So the whole team is participating right now.
That's good for these guys. Chronologic Gaming keeping the whole group together. 8 seconds now on Dragon. And look at this. CLG rotates down to the bottom half of the map. Mid lane getting swept out. Nien even sort of not backdooring the wave, but kind of killing it early so that nothing actually happens. No counter push here from Curse. And here comes a Dragon attempt.
Yeah, so you were right. They peeled off the top turret to go for the Dragon. Curse did hold that one. At the moment, Void Boy's just trying to get his items up a little bit. It's still so early on in the game, technically speaking, because we're only 18 minutes in, but it feels much later. The items just aren't there yet, and Curse can't fight without their items.
Now they absolutely can't right here. Ravenous Hydra still not done. Actually, Quas making a detour for a Negatron Cloak because he realized those javelins do in fact hurt him quite a bit. CLG actually not even continuing the siege. They're going to back off for now and grab up some items.
Well, they can actually start considering sweeping out the Baron area a little bit and maybe even going for that objective fairly early on here. It's crazy that Quas hasn't even finished his Sunfire Cape. When you just consider how long Nien has had his for, I think it was 5 or 6 minutes ago we talked about how Nien was so unstoppable because he had Sunfire Cape and Ninja Tabi.
Yeah.
And the diversified threat right now from CLG is stalling Curse's itemization, aside from the fact that they're just starved of gold.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, Nien has a 2,600 gold lead over Quas. He basically has a Sunfire of gold more than his opponent. You're seeing the minion kills are doubled exactly right now. Nien overall gigantic. He actually has second most gold in the game. Again, you talk about minion kills being distributed, but gold itself clearly spread apart very well. Also, Nien being a huge split pusher. Doublelift back to the top lane, though, for himself right now.
I would say the laning phase shrinking in this game and becoming very short hurt Quas more than anyone else. Since Curse has mainly just been sitting around at turret trying to defend, the ranged wave clear have been the ones that are catching up here. So it's actually just been Gragas and Caitlyn taking all of Quas's farm, and they've actually decided that Voyboy should be the one to counter the Mundo split push. That's why Quas is so low in gold. He's almost as low as the support as far as gold goes right now. It is 4,300 to 3,300 between him and Zekant, which is why his itemization has stalled so much. It's it's not a good sign because Quas needs to be that super tank. They're running a one tank team.
Yeah.
Right now it's a no tank team because he doesn't have items.
I feel like Voy probably is more durable than him right now just because he can lifesteal and has more levels. That's probably not, but like as far as hyperbole goes, it's not the worst choice. Hotshot, though, going to be back in the mid lane here. And yeah,
I think it's the proper choice by Curse to let Voyboy split push because they need his assassination potential. But it's just CLG's strategy that is preventing Quas from getting any farm. There's not much he could individually do to get it back at this point.
Not really. He's not been chosen to split against Nien. Oh, wow. Whew. Yeah, like when Nien was off to the side split pushing, his lane opponent was chosen as Voyboy. And they actually just split the mid and bottom lane over and over and over again. Quas out there tanking javelins and healing over and over. Poor guy, but it's the case right here. Nien gonna get hit a little bit. You can see some decent damage from Voy, but Nien can really tank it through. He's going Randuin's Omen next. Kind of suffers through that damage. No big deal. CLG takes the second top turret.
I mean, those are the isolated Qs hitting Nien as well. They're barely touching him. Voyboy's got to find a squishier target. The siege continues for CLG. That's six of them now.
21 minutes and 40 seconds. Counterlogic Gaming would rather kill turrets than enemy champions. That's fine. It is a good way to win the game right here. Dragons also all going to them. All six turrets gone. The next step, can they actually siege inhibitor turrets with the javelins, with the just ranged attacks from Elise, Nidalee, and Vayne?
What a strange game we have here.
Yeah.
I wonder how many more turrets can die without a champion kill. Really. Will CLG be able to clear off an inhibitor?
I feel like at some point...
Curse has just been so unwilling to engage.
Yeah. Unwilling and a little bit unable as well, just because Nien splits from so far away that he can teleport before his split push opponent can as well. And the fact that it's hard to engage on a team that's stronger than you and doesn't really overcommit.
Yeah.
There's been no Gragas engages, no catches whatsoever.
There's that one small opportunity at the dragon fight.
Well, Hotshot burns an early flash to make sure that doesn't go wrong for him. And now CLG, because they've owned this top jungle all game.
They can two-man this.
Wow, two-man
the rest of CLG can just keep Curse at bay. Hotshot's going to continue to throw his Nidalee spears, and they can do Baron. Curse could maybe guess that CLG was doing this Baron because Hotshot flashed away so quickly, which would indicate they didn't have any backup there.
Curse are moving.
Now they're trying to move towards it. I wonder if CLG is going to have to pull back on this one. Curse is here.
Is super low. Dominant might get the Miracle Steal. He's there. Oh, way too early. He didn't have any wards to put down. He couldn't check until just now. Blue team picks up Baron Nashor. Counterlogic Gaming. First champion kill along with Baron 23 minutes in.
Dominate absolutely panicked in that situation. His support was directly behind him, and they could have warded into the Baron and then tried to steal over the wall and combo it with his smite and all his spike damage. But look how close the rest of his team is. He sees the repel in, and he just decides to blindly body slam through. What was that? Zekant had a ward behind him. It allowed CLG an easy smite of the Baron. And now, with just the one kill, they should get an indefensible inhibitor away from Curse.
Well, inhibitor has already fallen. The respawn there for I Will Dominate. So it is a 5v5, but it's a 5v5 with a Baron buff and a giant 10,000 gold lead. Hook doesn't quite land, but they don't really need it. You can't hook turrets anyway, CLG. So Inhibitor down to 1/3, Nien still up front. This should be falling. Curse posturing a little bit. I just don't think they're really going to go in. Oh, they will! The knockup is in. Can the fight start and go well? Void might push back. Link very low, actually. Here comes Quas. Flayed backwards. Lulu will comes across. But Quas, you said he's not tanky, and you're seeing that here. Now Double getting jumped upon, but he's going to deal the damage. Dominic goes down. Nien still fighting over in the bottom lane. Hook's going to land on a cop. He's likely to go down. Goodbye. 4-0 for CLG, and they're already onto the Nexus.
With the three kills right here, they might get a flawless 25-minute victory, just total objective control. They're taking down the Nexus turrets, Freak.
They're going to be taking down the turrets, and to think, a four-kill game in professional. I don't think I've ever seen something go that low. If no one else falls here, that's an incredible record. That's
what
an incredible record.
What a strange game there by CLG. I mean, there's all smiles from Hotshot. He was 0-0-4. Technically, that's 100% kill participation if we're playing stat games right there.
Yep.
Just a really strange game because CLG had so much objective control early, and they just out-rotated Curse so well that Curse never really responded. Then by the time they went for Baron, Curse panicked a little bit, never had five people alive, and that's just a depressing way for Curse to lose.
It's got to be so frustrating as well when you're just like, we just never got to do anything.
No.
Curse never got to basically do anything against CLG. And that, it's funny because the game is so short, but that feels like old CLG, right? Like back when Hotshot was a starter. Super slow, super controlled, basically except, zero mistakes.
Yes. Except the laning phase for old CLG would go on for 35 minutes and then they'd start. Like this
instead
was,
of three.
I mean, it's old CLG in the sense that it was a low kill game, but it's completely different in the sense that they were grouping up so much and roaming. It's not that they had huge farm advantages. I mean, if you look at Hotshot versus Voidboy, the featured matchup, Voidboy had 20 more CS than Hotshot. Mm-hmm. Even Doublelift only had about 20 more than Cop. It was just the fact that there were 9 turret kills and 4 champion kills and never any real danger for CLG because they were always just moving around the map well.
They went in before the tanks got tanky. You talked about that with Quas. Really interesting setup by these guys. So,
strange.
CLG, done for the week. 2-2.
2-2. Very successful.
Good. Yeah.
That's an extremely successful week one for CLG. When you consider the fact that Hotshot came out of retirement for week one of the North American LCS
mm-hmm.
and ended up winning 2 games with CLG, they had 2 people playing out of position.
Yeah.
I mean, how much does that mess up with their actual style? It's huge. I mean, when Dexter comes in,
yeah,
they're going to expect to do even better.
And to think about it, right, when they brought in Hotshot, they had said that it was because we know how he plays, we know him, we've been around him for a while, we know this is comfortable for us. And I'm kind of thinking about the numbers. I feel like CLG's record with Hotshot is better than without, because they went negative win-loss in the summer split last season.
Percentage-wise, yeah.
Percentage-wise.
I believe they were, what, like 13-15?
13-15, yeah.
In the summer split. This actually also helps them out a little bit in their regular season record. Previously, they were 3-5 against Curse in the regular season.
Mm-hmm.
And 25 minutes and 1 second with only 4 kills. I'm still trying to really comprehend what happened. Curse only had 29,000 gold
mm-hmm.
in that game. They were so really heavily denied all of their objectives and a lot of their farming opportunities.
The only turret they got was because it was a 2v1.
Mm-hmm.
And no one bailed out in the end. They were too busy pushing the bottom lane, which worked for CLG.
Yeah.
Completely controlled game here. Yeah, so, of course,
it's a very good strategy by CLG,
yeah.
but it's also a really strange outcome from Curse because they
yeah.
played so well in the first 2 days. And even though CLG did rotate well, like there's a reason you don't see 25-minute 4-kill games that often is because there's counters and you can rotate with the team and stop them from doing those things.
Yeah.
And Curse just was not on the same page.
There was zero playmaking
yeah.
is my sort of read on
something
it. None of the individuals went to go do things.
Mm-hmm.
They sat and kind of got suffocated and kind of let themselves die.
Yeah.
All right, well, guys, we got to take a quick break, but we're just warming up. We've got 4 more LCS games today.